this, the 20th day, Sunday after Trinity, warm welcome to our friends from up the road, from St Boniface, and today is a joint service. And I will apologise at the end, Duncan and I will have to make a quick exit to get up to St Catherine's. But please do stay afterwards for tea, coffee, and lots of cake, which I've already seen is in the hall. Just like so we begin with our opening hymn, number 333, All My Hope on God is Faith. Love your neighbour as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets.
Amen. Lord, have mercy.
God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all. We say together, Almighty God,
our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own doing of cost. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you to be pleased in life, to the glory of your name.
Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in your goodness, and keep you in life eternal. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
From the west, but there is no one beside me. I am the Lord, Church of the Thessalonians, and God the Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace to you, and peace. We always give thanks to God for all of you, and mention you in our prayers, constantly remembering before God and Father the work of faith and labour and love, and steadfastness and hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. For we know, brothers and sisters, beloved by God, that he has chosen you, because our message of the gospel came to you not in word only, but also in power and in the Holy Spirit and with full conviction. Just as you know what kind of person we proved to be among you for your sake. And you became imitators of us and of the Lord, for in spite of persecution, you received the word with joy, inspired by the Holy Spirit, so that you become an example to all believers in Macedonia and in Athens. For the word of the Lord is sounded forth from you, not only in Macedonia and Athens, but in every place your faith in God has become known, so that we have no need to speak about it. For the people of those regions who cultivate us, what kind of welcome we had among you, and how you turned to God from idols to serve the living and true God, and to wait for his Son from heaven, who will be raised from the dead, Jesus, who rescues us from the wrath that is coming. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We stand and sing our gradual hymn number 346, City of God, how broad and far. Pharisees plotted to entrap Jesus in what he said, so they sent their disciples to him, along with the Herodians, saying, "Teacher, we know that you are sincere and teach the way of God in accordance with truth, and show deference to no one. For you do not regard people with partiality. Tell us then, what do you think? Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not?" But Jesus, being aware of their malice, said, "Why are you putting me to the test, you hypocrites? Show me the coin used for the tax." And they brought him a denarius. Then he said to them, "Whose head is this, and whose title?" They answered, "The emperor's." Then he said to them, "Give therefore to the emperor all the things that are the emperor's, and to God the things that are God's." When they heard this, they were amazed, and they left him and went away. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Many of you will remember the poll tax riots of 1990, when the Conservative government tried to change from rate systems on houses to a fixed rate. It was regarded as unfair on the poor, and opposition was particularly strong in the north of England and in Scotland. Eventually, the riots led to the resignation of Margaret Thatcher and was replaced by the council tax in 1993. But that incident was not new. The English poll tax of 1379 was one of the causes of the peasants' revolt in 1381. And things were no different in the time of our Lord. In 6 AD, Herod Archelaus was banished by the Romans, and Quirinius, the governor of Syria, took over tax purposes. This poll tax was extremely unpopular and caused a revolt by the Zealots, the freedom fighters, because this not only was a tax as an extra tax, it was also a reminder that Palestine was now occupied by a Roman power. In Judea, Romans had their own tax collectors, the Herodians. Thus, it is not surprising that Jesus asked, "Is it lawful to pay the tax to Caesar or not?" In context to our gospel reading, we need to remember it is Passover time. It is a time when Jerusalem was bursting to the seams with thousands of Jewish pilgrims who had come to celebrate this great feast that remembered and celebrated the escape from slavery of a foreign power. Nationalistic feelings ran at fever pitch. Pontius Pilate had travelled from his palace on the coast to Jerusalem with hundreds of Roman soldiers to police the event, which also reminded the Jews that they were dominated by a foreign power. Jesus was being watched by the Jewish leaders and by the Romans, because he had already caused trouble by his cleansing of the temple when he had overturned the tables of the money changers. We are told that the question had been asked to trap Jesus, to try and catch him out. Look who asks the question. It is an unholy alliance between the Pharisees, who resented paying taxes to the Romans, and the Herodians, who were pro-Roman sympathizers, who collected this tax for them in Galilee. The Pharisees had sent disciples, so if they could win a public debate against Jesus, then all was well and good. If they failed, then the Pharisees would not be personally embarrassed. Two groups with opposing views joined together to trap Jesus. It was a political question, a political trap. They begin with flattery and appear to be seeking advice from a knowledgeable rabbi concerning a troubling religious problem. Is it against our law to pay taxes to the Roman emperor or not? They ask. If Jesus answers, yes, pay taxes to Caesar, he will be regarded as a Roman collaborator and will alienate the ordinary people and lay himself open to possible death by the zealots. If he says no, do not pay the tax, then he makes himself appear to be a revolutionary who is fomenting a rebellion, so the Herodians could inform the Romans, who would then have a reason to arrest him. A simple yes or no answer would be fatal. Cleverly, Jesus asks to see a Roman queen with which the tax was paid, and asks whose name and image is on it. He is suggesting that if Caesar's name and image is on it, then it must belong to Caesar. Jesus asks to be shown a queen, because any pious Jew he would avoid, if possible, using a coin with an adulterous image on it. Certainly he would not carry such a coin in the temple area. Rome allowed the Jews to make their own copper coins of low denomination, which did not have any adulterous images on them. Remember, Jesus speaks of the old woman putting two copper coins into the temple tax box. The offensive coin was the silver denarius, which showed an image of the Roman emperor with the words, Tiberius Caesar, August son of the divine Augustus, high priest. Producing this coin shows that Jesus' questioners use these coins, so by reading the inscription, they know what to do with them. By having such coins in their possession, they were at least acknowledging Caesar's right to tax them. The coin is Caesar's. It bears his image. So it is appropriate to return the coin to him. But then Jesus adds, give back to God what belongs to God. This answer both puzzled and impressed the questioners. Jesus is making a further point. We must put God first. Jesus affirms the obligation to a higher political authority, but stresses a larger obligation to God. So, what do we have to
give back to God. At one level, Jesus might have been referring to the temple money for the upkeep of the temple. On another level, he could be talking about the coinage on which God's image is printed. According to Genesis 1:27, human beings are made in the image of God. If we are created by God in his own image, then we must belong to him. That means we must give him ourselves. Last week, I led 44 pilgrims to Walsingham on a retreat. And there, we all exercised exactly what Jesus states in today's Gospel. We gave to God what was God's. We gave ourselves back to him. We had time to be still, to communicate, to listen, to reconnect with God in many ways. We belong to God and are called to live lives that are faithful to him. We live with one foot in the kingdom of Great Britain and one foot in the kingdom of heaven. We cannot separate our religious and secular lives. We must live in both kingdoms. As good, responsible citizens, we must accept lawful authority, working for the good of all people in the community. Sometimes there may be a clash between our duties to the state and our duties to God. For example, the law may allow abortion on demand, or allow weapons to be sold to aggressive regimes. And soon the law may allow euthanasia. But for the Christian, it does not necessarily mean that these activities are morally right. If there is a genuine clash, then for the Christian, it should be God's law, not the state, that has the last word. In church, we declare the lordship of Jesus and dare to claim that loyalty to him is the highest priority of our life. But when we look into our life, and I mean really look into our life, is he the highest priority? And do you give unto God what belongs to God? Amen. And we stand to confirm our faith in the words of the Creed. We believe in one God,
the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things are made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again. fame and glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge our baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us now pray to the Father.
O Lord our God, you are great and greatly to be praised. You call your children by name and know our every need. You are our God, and there is none beside you. Gracious God, we pray for those who have never heard the message of your saving love, for those who are so consumed by things of the world that they are oblivious to the treasures of your kingdom. For those who once professed faith with confidence and now don't know what or who to believe, may they know the one who calls them by name. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for those whose labour of love is to take the gospel into all the world. With thankful hearts, we pray especially for all deacons, priests, and missionaries, for all bishops, peacemakers, for aid workers and teachers. We pray for Nicola, for Father Tony, Greg, and John, for our Bishop Jonathan and Archbishop Justin. Lord, in your mercy. O Lord our God, you are great and greatly to be praised. You are our God, and there is none beside you. We pray for those who know of you, but who have no faith or hope in you. Those who put their trust in human achievement and in earthly treasures. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
We pray for those who find themselves in dark places at this time, for those enfolded by grief, for those struggling with illness, for those raging with anger, for those who feel alienated or abandoned, for those who are held captive or imprisoned. We raise to you those we know, and in the silence, those in our hearts. And we pray for those known only to you, for you know us all by name. May the treasures of your grace bring peace, healing, and forgiveness. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for those whose labour of love is to show that you and you alone are worthy of worship. With thankful hearts we pray especially for our brothers and sisters in Christ who show forth your light and love in the world, for the church and for all places of sanctuary. Lord, in your mercy. O Lord our God, you are great and greatly to be praised. You are our God, and there is none beside you. We pray for those who seek to twist and distort the teachings of Christ and the prophets, those who actively work against your will, and those who persecute their neighbours. Lord, in your mercy. With thankful hearts, we pray for those whose labour of love is to live the Christian life, those whose lives and attitudes inspire and encourage us as we seek to live in obedience to your will and your way. We pray especially for the example of the saints, for the nourishment of prayer, for the refreshment of learning and the peace of your love. O Lord our God, you are great and greatly to be praised. You are our God, and there is none beside you. Merciful Father,
accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen.
Give me stand for peace.
Where two or three are gathered together in my name, says the Lord, there am I in the midst of them. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us offer one another a sign of peace.
We now sing our offertory hymn number 296, Lord enthroned in heavenly strength.
Oh,
continue on page 22. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
Father, we give you thanks and praise through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your living Word, through whom you have created all things, who was sent by you, your great goodness, to be our Saviour. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he took flesh. As your Son, born of the Blessed Virgin, he lived on earth and went about among us. He opened wide his arms for us on the cross, and put an end to death by dying for us, and revealed the resurrection by rising to new life. So he fulfilled your will and won for you a holy people. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and singing. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith. We bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people and gather into one in your kingdom, all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of St. Catherine, St. Boniface, and all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever, through Jesus Christ our Lord. By whom, and with whom, and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, for ever and ever.
Amen.
We continue on page 12. Let us pray.
pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
We break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread.
has come from heaven to deliver the world from the darkness of ignorance. Let these holy mysteries open the eyes of our understanding, that we may know the way of life and walk in it without stumbling. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
We say together, Almighty God,
we thank you for giving us the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, to remain the offering of our souls and bodies, to be a living sacrifice. Send us out to the power of your Spirit, to give in our blood to all praise and glory. Amen.
May I start by welcoming everybody to Holy Trinity this morning and reiterating that invite to join us for coffee and some very excellent cake in the church hall afterwards. Can I draw your attention to a few things on the pew sheets? We are collecting tombola prizes for our autumn fair. You'll see our autumn fair will happen on the 4th of November. So please, if you have something that you'd like to donate for Tombola, please bring it to church and we'll keep it in the vestry. And can I also extend thanks to everybody who helped at last Messy Church. The next one is on November the 25th. If anybody wants to help then, please do come forward. And there is a thank you here from Father Tony for thanking everybody who went to Paulson Home last week. If there is enough interest, we'll be doing it again next year. So please do speak to him if you want to go to that. Our service next week is at 9:30. It is a service of Holy Communion. Thank you very much.
So we stand and sing our closing hymn, number 452. Stand up and bless the Lord.
Oh, and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ.